This is Conversations with Barbara. My guest today is Jack Stanton. He is a Sandwich resident, and he is here to we are talking about his candidacy for state senate. Let's tell viewers what this district is going to be that you'd like to represent.
Certainly, Barbara. Thank you for having me on. So I'm running for the state senate in the Plymouth and Barnesville district. So it's six complete communities. I know how a lot of districts across the state, the towns kind of get broken up. Right. This is a district that is intact with all of the six municipalities that are in it, and it's three communities on the South Shore, three communities here on the Upper Cape. So on the Upper Cape, we have Sandwich, Bourne, and Falmouth, and then on the South Shore, we have Plymouth, Kingston, and all the way up to Pembroke.
I see. But are those, do you see common concerns across the that region?
Definitely. If you look at the district, five out of the six communities are coastal towns, communities that are on the water and have a lot of their economy derived from something having to do with the water, whether it is, you know, folks who make their living off of the water, or being tourist towns, which attract a lot of folks from out of town who visit those communities because of the sort of natural charm that they have.
Yes, so. Right. So we have tourist economies throughout. And so what are the concerns that you most will bring to the office of senator should you be elected?
So when I look at this district, there are three big things that I talk about. I think climate change is definitely a huge concern, being a coastal district. The science has come a very long way. And even in recent months, some of the projections on how this crisis is going to exacerbate over the next several decades is very, very severe. And as a coastal district, when we talk about things like sea level rise, and right now they're saying from Greenland's melting alone, that's going to create 6 inches of sea level rise. If you factor in all the other melting that's going on worldwide, that's 20 feet of sea level rise by the end of the century if we don't take action within the next decade or so.
And so you're close to this too, because you're a fisherman, so you've actually seen it in the temperature of the water?
Every day. It's something that we definitely see. We fish in southern New England. My boss has been, going offshore for 40 years, and southern New England is basically collapsed. The water temperature has reached a point where a lot of the lobsters have shifted to the north. This year, we had to move roughly half of our gear up to Georgia's Bank just because we weren't catching anything. We have a partnership with HUI here in Woods Hole, and they gave us a temperature probe that we stuck at the bottom of one of our trawls. And in early December, the bottom temperature in southern New England was 62 degrees. That's not normal. That's very, very concerning. Additionally, just changes in marine life. So we, and one of our, several of our trawls in southern New England, and when I say a trawl is it's about a mile long. It's a string of 40 commercial size pots. So they're very, very large pots, about 100 pounds a pop. And you haul your gear, load it on the boat, set it back out. We had entire trawls that were filled with scup and black sea bass. Now these are fish which are more attributed toward the sort of mid-Atlantic areas. And as the water warms, they're moving farther and farther north. So in my boss's 40-year career on the water, he was saying he had never seen situations like that. Fish that, you would see from time to time were, completely swarming our traps. And so those are just a couple of the examples of changes in climate that, I see on my day-to-day.
I can see that it's very real. There's no denying what's going on.
No, not at all. And so, when we talk about, things that we can do in the state level, I would rather not debate the science and let's treat this as an economic opportunity.
Right.
I think this can create jobs here in Massachusetts. Mm-hmm. And when we talk about some of the things that we can do to help in that transition to renewable fuels, it involves things that we should be doing anyways. So modernizing our public transportation system, making it easier for a lot of our older households here to be able to conserve energy, insulating their homes, finding ways we can save energy, using public lands so we can form municipal power structures. So towns that have any form of open space can sell energy back to the grid, and actually, you know, lower energy costs for residents within that particular community. Accelerating renewable energy industries here in the state, making our coastal infrastructure more resilient. And so there's a lot of things that we can be doing here that will actually create jobs. And so that's a lot of stuff that I've been talking about on the trail. Other issues of impact for this district, healthcare is an enormous concern. I know Massachusetts has this reputation for having the best healthcare in the country, but we still have a way to go. And I would say that, you know, moving towards some form of a single payer system is the most cost-effective way of handling our health system. So under our current system, we have a multi-payer health system. So, you know, you purchase insurance, your insurance company is who handles what your medical bills will be. But it still leaves gaps in coverage. There are people who are underinsured, don't have certain things covered, and a lot of times out-of-pocket expenses can be very expensive. And if you're a small business owner, you know, that is one of the most prohibitive things that you find in your cost increases every year. It's the one of the largest expenses you have, and one of probably the expense that is going up the fastest every year. And so, you know, a lot of folks kind of get scared of the thought of like having more government involvement in healthcare. And what I try and tell people is, it's just the ones who are footing the bill.
That's
you
right.
They're removing the insurance companies from the equation and creating a system which covers everyone because everybody's paying into it. And you, you'll find that, you know, services are expanded and households actually save money. So it would be a huge form of economic stimulus in the sense that businesses no longer have to insure their employees. You know, households would save hundreds, if not thousands of dollars a year on health expenses. So you're more likely to go get preventative care, which, you know, cuts costs. And you are able to you know, have a household save a couple hundred, thousand dollars a year, which is money you can go out and spend or save.
So how do you see taking these ideas and turning them into actual policies?
Certainly. Yeah. So, you know, what I've been telling a lot of folks on the trail is that, you know, we have a lot of great candidates that are running in this race, and we're really fortunate. The Democratic side, in that we all tend to agree on a lot of the same stuff. However, we need to change the way in which the state house operates. And so the way in which the state government functions, I would not say is transparent or accountable. It operates in secrecy in the sense that there are hardly any roll call votes. Your committee votes are often not public. And it is in that culture of secrecy where a lot of good pieces of legislation often go to die.
Yes,
because you can't keep tabs on what your legislators are doing. And so I think you need to have elected officials who are not sort of going up there to go along to get along, people who are going to take principled stands. And so, you know, you need to be able to work within the system to get pieces of legislation passed. But, you know, as an elected official, there's also an advocacy piece that I think a lot of folks who are in elected office kind of lose once they get kind of sucked up into that Beacon Hill world, which is not a real world. They kind of lose that connection to the communities that they come from. And so if you have a public office and enough people, you know, trust you with their vote to represent them, you can use that office to move the needle on public policy. You may not be able to get a piece of legislation passed instantly, but you can work with outside groups, organize at the grassroots, and use the weight of that office to speak out on the direction you think things should be moving. And so there is the inner dealings of the legislative process where you're trying to, you know, forge relationships and work with others to get stuff done. But I think, you know, there's also a great advocacy piece that you need to be working with outside groups to put pressure on that system in order to advance whatever your cause is. Because nothing big ever changes without, you know, outside advocacy putting pressure on the system. And the example I will bring up was the sort of grand bargain which the legislature passed in the 2018 legislative session. And one of the things that was on the agenda was, you know, the $15 minimum wage. and the Fair Share Amendment, where they wanted to, increase the taxes on those earning over $1 million, and a whole host of measures. And once they saw that that was going to go to a ballot measure, then the legislature decided to address it and pass it in a legislative session. But they only did that because folks took to the streets, gathered signatures, put it on a petition, and it was going to go to the ballot. And then they felt pressure, and they acted. Not all of the changes are necessarily going to come from that building. You have to go back out into your community and organize and put pressure on the folks.
Yeah. I see. You're very much in favor of public protest, public engagement in the, and you, of course you're right, that's critical.
Yeah, I mean, and people should participate in their democracy, and so it's you vote for your elected officials, and a lot of times, next time anyone thinks about, said elected officials is when the next election comes up. I was like, no, it's an ongoing conversation between you and your constituency. Right. And
I can see that you have no illusions about what life is like in the legislature. Do you think that your experience working in a foreign country has helped you understand differences of opinion or different ways of getting things done?
Definitely. So, when I started since I moved home, I've been working as a lobsterman, but, for the early part of my career, I worked in the international development sector. So I worked two contracts at the World Bank Group in Washington, D.C., and I eventually got a job with a research consultancy, which took me to Mozambique and Southern Africa. And so pretty much every job I had in my early career was in an international setting where I was one of, if not the only, Americans. And so what that sort of taught me was being able to work with folks from very different backgrounds, work with folks who may have very different values or different opinions than mine, but being able to work with them in order to pursue a common goal. And so, what I'll tell folks is that, I'm very, very principled. I have, my values that I stand for, but I can work with anybody, and I can disagree without being disagreeable. And I think that's a very, very important skill to have if you're seeking to be a legislator, because you're not always going to get what you want, but you have to know where you stand and what your values are, and, address each situation clear-eyed and moving forward in a direction where you can move the needle. So.
I in your piece on the internet, I read that you are very much interested in making Election Day a public holiday, and I think we need to do something to get the vote out, because in a democracy, the statistics are very very disappointing. Let's talk about how you think that would work.
So I mean, I see. A holiday like Columbus Day that we have, which, celebrates a man who committed many atrocities in his life, and yet we have our right to vote, which is, the most cherished thing that one has in being an American citizen, something that a lot of people fought and died for. And why we would not make Election Day every year a public holiday, so people can go and do their civic duty and actually encourage civic participation, makes no sense to me.
Maybe we should eliminate Columbus Day.
Well, yeah, if you don't want to add a new holiday to the calendar, I mean, I'm in favor of an Indigenous Peoples Day where we honor some of our, Native brothers and sisters. But, I think, swapping a holiday from Columbus Day to something like an Election Day holiday would make sense, right?
It does. It's a critical day. And, voting doesn't have to be onerous. It can be fun.
Yeah, exactly. And so I think if you had it as a public holiday, you would actually be encouraging people to go out and vote. You go out with your family, you go out with your friends, you go out and vote, and then, maybe have a little gathering. As having that as either a state holiday, ideally it would be a federal holiday, but let's focus on what we can do here in Massachusetts.
That's right. And so you are also really very much in support of civic engagement. You want more people to become involved and to become knowledgeable about what's going on in the legislature.
Definitely. I think it's important that people get involved. I think it's important that folks you know, have somewhat of a relationship with their elected officials. And I think, you know, anyone should be able to step forward and run for office if they have an understanding of the community that they come from.
Yes, it is. One of the things you I know that you have talked about is the fact that we have candidates who just have all kinds of money, and it's the money that gets them elected, and that really is sad.
Yeah, I mean, you know, in my...
You'd like to have public funding.
I would. So the way, I mean, I think elections should be contests of ideas.
Yes.
And so, you know, we talk about the concept of term limits frequently, and I agree with that in principle. In practice, I don't think it works out. I think if you were to have public funding of elections, so making it so anyone could run for office, provided you could demonstrate enough community support, mm-hmm. so maybe, you know, raise the requirements to be able to get onto the ballot. But if you're able to demonstrate enough community support to get onto the ballot, I think you should be entitled to public funds, which would be the same for everyone. Mm-hmm. So much like the NFL draft, you know, everybody has the same amount of resources at the start. Right. And as a team manager, as a candidate, you determine how you want to allocate those resources. Yeah. I mean, if you look at other countries, places like Canada, the United Kingdom, Australia, their election windows can be a couple of weeks, and then it's done. Mm-hmm. And so regular folks are more able to step forward and run for office because they don't have to take time off from work. You don't have to be independently wealthy. You know, you can, you know, present yourself and make your case to the public, you win or lose, and then you move on. So,
and then also a candidate is not beholden to the person who's giving him the most money.
Absolutely. You know, you're beholden to the people that put you in office, especially given that anyone else who would like to challenge you in, you know, 2 years, 4 years, whatever the limit is able to do that. And so you'll have truly competitive elections with multiple candidates every cycle, and that should be. I mean, people, I think, get involved politically and then they just make these sort of like little careers for themselves. And it's very, very difficult to dislodge an incumbent once you get into office, because you gain name recognition, you build a war chest of money, and it becomes very, very difficult to dislodge folks who may not be good elected officials. Mm-hmm. And so I think competition is a good thing. We should have competitive elections, and I think public funding would actually make it so elections are more vigorous sort of contests of ideas and not how much money you're able to raise. So, you know, as a young candidate, I'm 28 years old, a fisherman, is running in my home community. It's not as easy for me to run for office because I don't have the luxury of having been in the workforce for 20, 30 years and having the sort of large networks of donors that I can tap to contribute. And so, you know, there are disadvantages for certain folks who are running for office and want to make a contribution. So I think, there should be a level playing field and would encourage to have more working people who are able to step forward and run for office. So.
Yeah, I think what's interesting is that, we're thinking about is that your view is that great ideas like this don't happen in political circles. They happen outside. They happen in the public. So we need to have movements, perhaps writings about public financing of elections. I know there's talk about it, but it hasn't really risen to become a force.
Right.
So your platform is raising that question, which is a good thing.
Definitely.
Right.
Definitely.
Right. And when you were at Georgetown, did you study government?
So it was at George Washington, not Georgetown. So right down the street.
Right,
so
right down
Georgetown's up on the hill, and we're down in Foggy Bottom, closer to the White House, but not government. I was an international affairs major, it was a blend of economics, political science, government, foreign policy, language, geography. Mm-hmm. And so you really get this sort of interdisciplinary approach of viewing the world and how the United States sort of fits in with the world system, how the international economic system functions, and just taking a more macro approach to sort of have understanding world problems. Mm-hmm. And so I think, you know, it was definitely, as someone who grew up in a small town, I grew up in Sandwich, it definitely opened a lot of doors for me in terms of perspective and kind of starting a career, which really took me to a lot of different places, of which I've been very fortunate.
Yeah, and this isn't your first election.
No, it's not.
Tell us about what you've learned.
So, I moved home from my posting in Mozambique in late 2017, and last year I ran for state representative in the 5th Barnstable District, which covers all of Sandwich, two precincts in Barnstable, three precincts in Bourne, and one precinct in Plymouth. It's a pretty conservative district, and I don't think it's ever really been held by a Democrat before, at least not since the district was created in 02. And we did quite well. I mean, I was, it was first time for me running for office before, and we really kind of took it to the grassroots. And so it was a campaign that was focused on getting as much voter contact as possible.
Right,
and so
right.
I knocked on a lot of doors. Right. And when I was going door to door with people, it was not me sort of proselytizing, saying why they should vote for me. I would go show up at someone's door and introduce myself, and I'd ask what issues were on their mind. And I think that's disarming for a lot of people because it's like, oh, you're showing up to my house and you actually want to know what I think. And I do. I mean, you get a really good sense of what sort of problems, issues are on people's minds as you go door to door. And you get to have sort of real, candid conversations with folks.
Yes, and I know what you're saying, and it seems to me that we have noticed that sometimes when somebody's in public office, they become detached and kind of not really as aware of what's happening on the ground, except for voicing opinions, but that detachment is not a good thing, so you've had that connection.
Absolutely, and it was fun for me. I mean, I like going out and banging on people's doors and just talking to folks about what concerns are on their mind. It's real. It's human. It's politics at its base level is a wonderful thing, and I think I think a lot of folks kind of go to Beacon Hill or they go to Washington and they sort of kind of forget where they come from because they're operating in an environment that is not sort of connected to the concerns of the people that put them there. And I think we need to have more elected officials that reflect the communities that they come from, and not only understand the challenges from their community, but maybe living them themselves. And so they have a lot more skin in the game in terms of wanting to make improvements in their community.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You certainly have learned a lot as a fisherman from that perspective. What fishermen would like to see. In terms of legislation, what are those issues that fishermen are facing? Because we have lots of viewers who are fishermen.
Definitely. I mean, regulation is definitely something that comes up a lot. And like we were talking about earlier today, regulation can get complicated. But I think, in the fishing community, I feel like a lot of folks feel like their voices aren't particularly heard in the rooms where a lot of these decisions which impact our livelihoods are made. Another piece of it is, working in this field is, shown me the concept of hard work for people. I mean, our trips are 6 days dock to dock. It takes us a day to get out to the fishing grounds. We haul gear for 4 days. We get in and unload on the morning of the sixth day. This is really hard, grueling, dangerous, backbreaking work. And that's what a lot of people who live in this particular community need to do in order to be able to survive.
Right.
And so, despite having, gone to school at NDC and, having worked overseas and having a very different career path, I just moved home. I've been doing this for 2 years now.
Right.
And so I have a very...
It must be humbling.
Humbling, but it just gives me an understanding of, this is what most people have to do to be able to survive in the Cape. Whether it's you're a contractor, or you're a roofer, or you're a landscaper. I mean, people work really, really hard in order to be able to survive here on the Cape and on the South Shore. And I think it's important to have, elected officials who are aware of that struggle and can sort of speak meaningfully to the concerns that these everyday working people have in the state government. So I don't think aside from Pat Kearney, a friend of mine who's the state rep from Marshfield and Scituate, who does have a fishing background. There's really no fishermen in the state legislature, so it'd be a neat little addition. I think I definitely would make some valuable contributions.
Yes, you're representing a very important constituency.
Sure, right, sure. I mean, it's the it was the livelihood of the Cape for hundreds of years, so. And has really been diminished in recent decades. So
I know that you're really quite concerned too about health care in this state. You've talked a little bit about that. And what would you like to see? Are you interested in, say, single payer?
Single payer, absolutely. That is the way forward. We have over half a century's worth of data from the OECD, which is the sort of like rich club, the club of like rich, wealthy, developed economies. And we are the only country within this grouping of wealthy countries that doesn't have some form of a single payer system. Yeah. It's cost effective, it will save people money. Right. And I cannot overstate that enough. It's like, yeah, your taxes will go up, but what do you pay in copays and deductibles and premiums? That's a form of a tax. And so your health spending on healthcare is actually going to go down significantly if you move to single payer, and it's going to cover everything. And so, if you're feeling ill, you're more likely to go to the doctor to get that checkup, and it's always better to get preventative care than just showing up in the emergency room waiting for the sickness to get worse, and it becomes more costly, more expensive, and more difficult for the system to treat. So overall, it would lead to better coverage, a more streamlined, efficient system, and better health outcomes, which is what we want. We want healthy people. Yeah. So.
Well, it's been wonderful talking to you, and I am so happy that you have been here to let viewers know what your views are. And so I wish you well. And the election, let's let everyone know when the election is going to be held.
March 3rd. So it's going to be the date 3rd. Of the presidential primary. And it's going to go to two ballots, which I don't think a lot of folks are aware of. Oh. So, you'll go in and you'll go vote for your candidate for president. However, you'll go in, vote for your candidate for president, and then you'll have to go in and get a second ballot if you want to vote in the state Senate primary.
Okay.
So be sure to do that.
Yes.
It's important.
Right.
And, as I've said before, down ballot elections are very, very important. Most of your tax dollars get spent at the state level, not at the federal level.
Yeah, that's very
and
true.
So, your state that's senator, your state rep, those are important races that you have to make sure you participate in.
Yeah, great. Thank you very much.
Thank you for having me.
It's been great.
Good luck. Thank you.
And thank you for viewing. We look forward to seeing you next time on Conversations with Barbara.